It was near dawn today when two large explosions rocked Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, smoke billowing in the morning sky. The missiles came from Yemen's Iran-aligned Houthi movement. Violence in Yemen is surging after a six-week ceasefire prompted by the pandemic ended last month. The war-ravaged nation has been facing disease and hunger for 6 years now. Special correspondent Jane Ferguson reports.
Every day in Yemen's southern city of Aden, they're digging more fresh graves, struggling to keep up with the rising body count. Rows of deep mud holes ready to accept the dead as families bury their loved ones quickly with little ceremony. In this cemetery, many of the graves have already been filled. These are busy days for grave diggers like Mohammed Obaid.
Thankfully, yesterday and today have been better, with less funerals. Before, we had about 50 to 60 dead a day. We hope to God that people live longer.
Officially, there have been fewer than 300 deaths in Yemen from the virus. But the bodies keep coming. And with limited testing, there is no real way of knowing how many people across the country are sick and dying. War, hunger, and disease have already ravaged people here for 6 years. Now death stalks the country again in a new cloak.
We hear of so many cases of people dying, and sometimes from our friends in other places too. Recently, our next-door neighbor died, and no one knows why.
In Yemen, the virus is only the latest in a long list of calamities. The war here broke out in 2014 when Houthi rebels seized control of the capital, Sana'a. Their support comes from neighboring Saudi Arabia's archenemy, Iran. So the Saudis formed a coalition of local and foreign forces to fight the Houthis. Their aerial bombing campaign, supported by the United States, and a blockade of rebel-held areas has destroyed much of the country's infrastructure and collapsed the economy. The Houthis constantly interfere with international aid sent to help, trying to tax the goods and force aid organizations to give them control over distribution, leaving millions of innocents to suffer. Severe flooding struck Aden in April, damaging whatever was left of sewage and water systems, only helping to spread the disease. Now, some frightened medical staff are refusing to come to work, according to Dr. Ishrek Al-Subayi, a government official trying to contain the spread.
Medical personnel are terrified, as all medical staff in the world. Around five of them have died.
The internationally recognized government isn't able to offer much help, since they are all in self-imposed exile in Saudi Arabia.
I am very worried because I can be infected.
Despite these risks, Dr. Hisham Farouk still comes to help his patients every day. In this hospital in Taiz, on the front lines of Yemen's war, the need has never been more desperate. For the people of Yemen, the fighting brought with it pestilence. Diseases such as cholera, diphtheria, dengue fever, malaria have all run wild, and now COVID-19. Add to that devastating hunger. 80% of the people here rely on aid for their survival, and famine continues to stalk the most vulnerable, unable to afford to buy food with the country's economy in tatters. Half of Yemen's medical facilities are shut down because of the war's chaos and destruction.
If 100 confirmed cases emerge that required health care, I'm sure that the rest of the health system will collapse more than it's now.
The virus is not stopping the violence. It's only getting worse. Peace deals and ceasefire agreements are failing once more. And even the United States has stood in the way of calls for laying down arms. Last month, the U.S. blocked a U.N. Security Council vote that called for a global ceasefire to help combat coronavirus. In an email to the NewsHour, the State Department wrote that their goal was always to support the Secretary General's call for a global ceasefire. Unfortunately, the People's Republic of China was determined to use this resolution to advance false narratives about its response to the COVID-19 outbreak in Wuhan. The U.S. provides intelligence and logistics to Saudi Arabia and its coalition partners fighting in Yemen, while American firms have profited through billions of dollars worth of weapons sales.
the U.S. government that is involved in Yemen to a certain degree needs to actually back these efforts for a ceasefire and not block them.
Sama Hadid is the spokesperson for British charity Oxfam, a major provider of aid on the ground in Yemen.
The country cannot deal with ongoing fighting and a crisis, a health crisis of this magnitude. So instead of hindering peace processes and peace talks, a government like the US needs to actually back, you know, the calls for a ceasefire and back efforts for warring sides to come together and actually commit to containing this virus.
Right now, the opposite is happening. Fighting between coalition forces and the Houthis rages on. And now a second war within this war is emerging. While Saudi-led coalition airstrikes rain from above, Yemeni groups on the ground do the fighting. Those factions are a mixture of militias and government soldiers, supposed to be fighting the Houthis. Now they are also fighting one another. Saudi-backed government troops are clashing with separatist groups. Yemen's north and south were once two separate countries, and these fighters hope to gain independence once again.
From our point of view, that the peace will never happen unless we get to our origin state, that the south will become a dependent state and also the north is a dependent state.
The government of Yemen did not respond to our request for comment on the coronavirus or renewed fighting.
No one cares about us, not the separatists, not the official government, and not the NGOs. Everyone just cares about their own interests.
In the rebel-held capital Sana'a, the Houthi government has banned all filming by foreign media. The group insists there have only been four positive coronavirus cases in the capital and has not released any additional test results to the aid agencies. Yemen has dealt with disease, famine, and conflict for so long, it's hard to imagine a place less prepared to handle a pandemic like this. For 30 million people who have already suffered so much, the odds on their daily struggle to survive grow even longer. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jane Ferguson.